My theory is that he died as the result of a chariot accident because he's got a lot of damage to his chest area. So badly damaged, and it was damaged before the mummification bandages went on. But all sorts of theories have been suggested, from murder to malaria to have killed him. That's a really good question. We don't actually know who Tutankhamun was, in that we don't know who his parents were, but we do know that he was a pharaoh or king of Egypt, and he ruled Egypt at what we call the end of the 18th dynasty, and he came to the throne in approximately 1336 BCE. We know who his wife was, but we don't really know, actually, you know, setting him and his family, who he was.
And what do we know about his reign?
His reign was about 10 years. He came to the throne as a child. He was about 8 years old. We know this because we have his body, and we have records that show he was on the throne for 8 years. So we can tell that he must have come to the throne as a child, and he died quite young, at about 18 or 19, possibly as the result of an accident, although there are all sorts of theories about how he died. During his reign, he had a lot to do because of the time that he inherited the throne. He came at the end of what we call the Amarna Age, where there'd been a different sort of religion practiced in Egypt, and he spent his entire reign basically putting things back to how they'd been before the Amarna Age. So he re-established the traditional gods.
And what do we know about his health?
We have Tutankhamun's body, so we can say certain things about his health, but the experts are, you know, completely undecided on these things. Some people say that he was well-nourished, some people say he was malnourished. Some people say he had a club foot, but other people say no, that's because of the bandaging when he was mummified, just twisted his leg under, because that does happen. If the bandages is too tight, you will get the effect of a club foot. We can see that he'd had a nasty accident because all his chest area is very, very badly damaged and his heart is missing, so that is undeniable. It's been suggested that he had a cleft palate, but not a very obvious one. It might not have been obvious in life. So really, really difficult to say anything about his health. Some people say that he would have walked with a walking stick because of his limp, and there are lots of sticks in his tomb. Other people say no, there are lots of chariots in his tomb. We have images of him fighting, and these sticks are not walking aids, but they're symbols of authority, and that lots of men carry sticks. Oh, and some people say that he's had tuberculosis, which there's no proof of that. He does seem to have had malaria, but having reached 18 years of age, he probably didn't die of it because he would have probably had a certain degree of immunity from then. So not particularly helpful, I'm afraid. Sorry.
Well, right, because the next question is probably not going to be very helpful either, because it's one of the biggest questions around this, which is, how did Tutankhamun die?
We don't know how Tutankhamun died. My theory is that he died as the result of a chariot accident, because he's got a lot of damage to his chest area, so badly damaged, and it was damaged before the mummification bandages went on. They couldn't mummify him in quite the way they would normally do it. He's also got damage to a leg. But all sorts of theories have been suggested, from murder to malaria to have killed him. But I think, given that he's a young man, and speed kills so many young men, I tend to think hunting ostriches in the desert. There's a fan that was put in his burial chamber very close to his body, and it's an ostrich fan which was once decorated with ostrich plumes in alternate brown and white, and there's pictures of him going out to hunt ostrich and come back, and I like to think that's a clue that's been left to us by the ancient undertakers to show us, maybe just hint at what happened. It would be very unlucky to write down how a king died, so they didn't do it, but maybe that's a clue. I don't know.
So he's died, perhaps in his chariot accident. And what happened to his body when he died?
Normally, when you die, you would go fairly quickly to the undertakers, just because Egypt is a hot country. And he would undergo traditional mummification, a high quality of mummification, because he's royal. But there are signs that he maybe didn't get rushed to the undertakers as quickly as we would wish him to have been, because his heart was missing. So there's just a slight doubt, did he die in the desert maybe, or too far away from an undertakers? So did he actually start to decompose before he got to the undertakers? We really don't know, but the signs are that maybe he was a bit late getting there and being preserved.
So what happens to Tutankhamun in Egypt after his death, i.e. his legacy?
During his lifetime, Tutankhamun was very much promoting himself as a restorer king. He was putting things back after the Amarna period, which is the period that had gone before, when Egypt had worshipped basically one god. It wasn't monotheism, but it was close to it. So he was promoting himself as a traditional pharaoh. But when he died, he was so closely associated with the Amarna Age and this bizarre worship that he was pretty much written out of Egyptian history and forgotten. So when the Ramesside scribes wrote down the history of Egypt, they just missed him out. And nobody really knew much about him. He wasn't entirely forgotten because he'd left statues, he'd built and so on. He had a tomb, he had a mortuary temple. But his tomb was pretty quickly lost. It was in the floor of the Valley of the Kings and there was a big flood. And the flood put down debris on top of it and it was forgotten. And because he wasn't a prominent king, nobody really looked for it. And his mortuary temple, which is where his cult should have been celebrated for all eternity, was dismantled and reused by other people. So when that had happened, not in the written records, very little in the archaeology, he was just basically forgotten about. His name was known, but no one would have really thought anything of him.
How was his tomb discovered and by whom?
Tutankhamun's name wasn't forgotten, even though no one knew anything about him. In fact, people thought he was an elderly man who'd taken the throne. He'd married into the royal family, and that's what people thought he was. So when most of the bodies and tombs of the kings of the 18th dynasty were found, it became obvious that there was one missing, and this was Tutankhamun. So people actually set out to look for him. His tomb wasn't found by chance. It wasn't a random thing. He was actually being sought. Several people looked, but eventually the people looking were Lord Carnarvon and Howard Carter. They were very, very sure that he would be in the Valley of the Kings because that's where his ancestors were buried and that's where a restorer king would want to be buried. So that's where they looked. And they decided basically to take down the rock of the Valley of Kings on to the bedrock to look for the tomb. And that's what they did. And eventually they found the steps. When I say they, obviously the team working for it, it wasn't just the two of them. There was a big team of workers who did it. And the steps were found. But it wasn't the chance that people think it was. He didn't just stumble across it.
So what are some of the greatest treasures discovered from the tomb?
The tomb's absolutely packed full of wonderful objects. And everyone has their favourites. I mean, the ones that people always are very impressed by are the coffins and the funerary mask, which is more like a helmet, actually. It goes over the head. But certainly the innermost coffin and the funerary mask are made of solid gold, and they're very, very impressive. But almost everything in there is absolutely wonderful because there's so many beautiful, intricate, and just instructive things. We've even got things like leather loincloths in there, and we've got jewellery, we've got food, we've got beds, chariots. There's something for everyone in there. An amazing collection of things.
Is there any particular object that is your personal favourite?
Well, I've already mentioned that I really like the ostrich fan, but there's also garments in there, which at first were ignored pretty much because I don't think the excavators thought they were that interesting. And also, it's very difficult to preserve linen. But increasingly, they've been studied by experts. And it's now very clear that the garments in the tomb aren't just the garments of Tutankhamun, aged 18, the restorer king. There's also clothes in there from when he was a child. And he's also got his childhood jewellery in there. So it seems very clear that he's buried basically everything he wore from the time he became king, which I think is really interesting. And also, having these garments, we can kind of reconstruct his life from the point where he became king onwards. It's almost as if the essence of kingship has sort of suffused the garments and they couldn't be given away or reused in any way, and they have to be buried with him so that he can presumably use them in the afterlife, or at least so that no one else can use them. And I find that absolutely fascinating. And his clothes, they're not just the normal white clothes that we tend to think of Egyptian royalty wearing all white, don't we, or the elite wearing all white, but they're beautiful, embroidered, appliqued, colourful garments.
What is the scientific study of his body, shall we say, like CT scans, DNA, x-rays, what has all this revealed about Tutankhamun?
Almost from the time that his tomb was discovered and it was realised that his body was in the tomb, scientists have been interested in looking at the body. And the hope has always been that it'll tell us more about his life and his death. And this is continued. Not everybody's happy with it. Some people think it's not really going to tell us very much and he should be left alone. But on the whole, this has continued. And there's been DNA analysis done. There's been scans done. The problem is, particularly with the DNA analysis, the technique itself is actually quite new, and there's a lot of dispute still about how accurate it is. So though attempts have been made to slot him into the royal family and say who his parents are and if he's got children and so on, not everybody's convinced that this is working, because mummy DNA is such a new technique, and it's so prone to contamination from human DNA and from heat damage and from maybe the chemical damage caused during mummification. So we have been able to use these techniques and more simple techniques, like just looking at the bones and so on, to work things out about his body and his life and his death. But at the moment, I don't think we've not got the full story yet. It's still developing because the techniques are still developing. And it's really interesting because archaeologists, Egyptologists are so much in different camps as to which bits are successful, which bits are not. We have to, I think, look at everything that everybody's done with it and try and pull it all together and tell one story from the evidence we have. But at the moment, that's not quite happened. So I don't think we're quite there in understanding what we would like to understand from his body. But I think it'll happen one day.
And then, of course, the biggest question of all, Joyce, the one that everyone wants to know the answer to and all the stuff surrounding it, the curse. Joyce, what is the curse? Talk us about the curse of Tutankhamun.
The curse of Tutankhamun is such a complicated subject, and it sounds so simple. Basically, what happened is that when Lord Carnarvon's team, he was funding the team, discovered the tomb of Tutankhamun, he could tell that he was going to have to pay for quite a few years to get the tomb emptied and the goods conserved. So they'd found the tomb, but that wasn't the end of it. They had to take everything out of it and make sure that he went to Cairo Museum. He did expect, however, that he would get some of these grave goods for himself, because that's how it worked in those days. It doesn't work like that now. We wouldn't expect to go to Egypt and bring anything back with us, but those days he did. And so he was looking for a way to, I suppose, get some of the expenses paid up front, because he knew that when he got some of the grave goods, he'd be able to sell them or give them to people. But until that point, and it could be several years in the future, and in fact, it took 10 years to empty the tomb, He was just paying for emptying the tomb. So he did a deal with the Times newspaper, which said that only the Times journalist was allowed in the tomb, and that anybody who wanted to read about what was happening in the Valley of the Kings could only read it via the Times, which, of course, this went really, really badly with the world's press, who wanted to read about it, and, of course, the Egyptian press, who could only read about what was happening in their own country to their own dead king by reading the Times of London. So it was not a good thing. But it meant that there were a whole host of angry and unsupportive journalists who wanted to write about the tomb of Tutankhamun but weren't allowed to access any information. So they started to look for other things to write about. And the Egyptologists wouldn't talk to them, but other people would. People like Ryder Haggard and Conan Doyle, people who were sort of considered by the general public to be experts on the occult and ancient Egypt and the supernatural because they'd written popular books about the subject, but weren't actually Egyptologists. Then, very sadly, Lord Carnarvon died not long after discovering the tomb, or the tomb was being discovered. And this was something that the journalists could write about. So they wrote a lot about the death, but they picked up on people like Marie Corelli in particular, who was a well-known Gothic author of the time. And she said, oh, I always thought that this was terrible, that he was interfering in this tomb, and I've got a secret book that says there's a curse in there. And this started to get published, and the journalists carried on doing it. And then it became rumoured that there were curses in the tomb. Then it became rumoured there was a curse above the door to the tomb, but that Howard Carter had taken it down in case it frightened people. Then they started to connect completely random deaths to Tutankhamun. So if somebody died who'd been anywhere near Tutankhamun's tomb, they would say that it was the curse. And it really, really took hold in the public imagination. And because the public is sort of programmed to expect bad things from mummies, because there are already mummy stories in circulation, it really, really took hold. But there is, in fact, no real curse inside the tomb at all. And met various people who studied the statistics. I don't know why various people have done it, because you only need to do it once. They've looked at the age, the deaths of the people who were there when the tomb was first opened, and most people live perfectly normal, long lives. You know, there's nothing untoward. There's no sudden death of all the archaeologists who've entered the tomb. So there's nothing really to support the idea of the curse. But it suddenly got into the public imagination. It matched people's expectations of mummies and the idea that the Egyptians had a superior knowledge of the afterlife and a superior knowledge of religion. And it also fitted with the time, because it's just after the Great War and it's just after the great influenza epidemic. A lot of people have lost loved ones. A lot of people are trying to contact the dead. They're happy to believe the Egyptians have superior knowledge in this respect. And it all fitted together, and it just grew and grew and lingers today.
Why is the centenary, why is the discovery of Tutankhamun, why is it so significant?
Tutankhamun's really become, I think, an ancient world celebrity. He means so many different things to so many people. To the Egyptian people, particularly in the 1920s, when the tomb was discovered, he became a signal of Egyptian independence. This was an Egyptian pharaoh who was coming back at just the point that they were fighting for independence from the British. To other people, they've read it as, just because it's fascinating, treasure-seeking, Indiana Jones-type story. Other people, again, because they're really interested in ancient religion. Other people are interested in the occult and see the two connected. There seems to be almost something in it for everybody. And so the world has been absolutely fascinated. And again, the time that this happened, it was an excavation that was being conducted almost in front of the world's eyes, because for the first time it was in the newspapers, it was on the wireless. It was even in little film reels. So people, and there were photographs, you know, people knew what was happening. So other great discoveries hadn't been so public. And it just reached a tipping point. And when it slowly died away, interest in it slowly died away after the tomb was emptied. But when you get to 1972 and the touring Tutankhamun exhibitions, certainly in Britain and other places as well around about that time, it reignited. There was a massive public interest in it, and it still continued to this day. And you still meet people who will talk about the 1972 Tutankhamun exhibition and how they went to it or how they remember it. And it was a defining moment for a lot of people. And it's just carried on. It's famous for being famous now. But also the tomb offers us so much as well. I mean, finally, as an archaeologist, it's quite fashionable to say, well, Tutankhamun's very popular. But actually, there's so much information in those grave goods that we could study those for a lifetime and still not get to the end of it.
Hi folks, I'm Dan Snyder on a History Hit TV Adventure Antarctica. You should subscribe, because we've got a lot more of this kind of thing coming up, including digs on the former battlefields of the Western Front. As subscribers, you can use the code YouTube to get 50% off your first 3 months.